second speaker, who's going to talk on the recent trends in physiotherapy for rehabilitation of rheumatoid arthritis, which is another commonest problem that we have. This is going to be spoken by Lourdes Raj, who did his BPT from Tamil Nadu, Dr. MGR University, and MPT from RGHS. He worked as chief physiotherapist in Mother Venin Hospital and lecturer at Well RS Medical College, Chennai. Presently, he is working as assistant professor at Gautam College of Physiotherapy, Bangalore. He has done various workshops, especially in neurodynamics, manual therapies in clinical reasoning, evoked potential, blink reflexes, decremental studies, and so on and so forth. I now call upon Dr. Raj to go ahead with this lecture.
Thank you, sir. Before proceeding with the last session of today, I would like to thank Dr. Chandrasekhara, Dr. Kishore Reddy, and the team of Chan Ray Rheumatology, Immunology, and Research Center for giving me this opportunity to stand over here with this topic. See, today I'm going to speak about the recent trends in physiotherapy, the rehabilitation of rheumatoid arthritis patient. You may be taxed with all the informations what you people are receiving the whole day. Hope mine will be a bit refreshing, I believe, which is going to be crisp. Before proceeding with the physiotherapy, as you all know, we define the rheumatoid arthritis as a chronic and painful clinical condition that leads to progressive joint damage, disability, deterioration in the quality of life. And even the mild inflammation may result in irreversible damage and permanent disability. It is a systemic autoimmune disorder of unknown etiology. Why I am stressing upon this definition? Because as a therapist, before proceeding with the assessment, I should know the condition clinically very well. Then only my assessment will be proper so that I can plan my treatment goals and go according to the management. Next slide, please. And rheumatoid arthritis, it is a multi-joint disorder. And the commonly involved joints are the cervical spine, shoulder, elbow, the hand, wrist and fingers being the most victim, knee, hip, foot and ankle. This list shows that the physiotherapist role is not as simple enough to deal with this rheumatoid arthritic cases, because we have to deal with the multiple areas of these patients. They don't come with one single joint involvement when they are referred for the physiotherapy. Next slide, please. See, this diagram shows you how the disease invades the joint. The first one shows the early changes of rheumatoid arthritis, and the next one shows you the advanced changes of rheumatoid arthritic joint. Next slide, please. So before going to the recent trends, what is the role of a therapist on the assessment? Of course, involving the multi-joint, our assessment is also very wide. Before starting the therapy, the physiotherapy needs of patients are determined in accordance with their incapacity, disability and handicaps. The physical assessment should include these components especially to go according to the treatment, the range of joint of all the joints, the muscle strength test. You may be knowing, we have got now the latest trend of assessing the muscle strength using isokinetic equipment also, apart from the manual muscle testing. We have got to do the postural assessment, and we need to evaluate the respiratory function too, because these joint deformities may be causing them a lot of respiratory distress too in the advanced stages. So there is a need to go with the evaluation of the respiratory function too. Then we need to go in detail with the functional assessment that involves the transfer status, the analysis of gait, and the activities of daily living. Next slide. With that, we can devise our treatment goals So it is essential that we establish a goal of treatment towards which we can work as we care for patients with rheumatoid arthritis, so that our approach is orderly and it is focused towards their improvement. And the most appropriate goal is to improve and maintain a patient's functional capacity and the quality of life rather than anything. The next slide. So our main treatment goals is to educate the patient. See, these patients are having the problem and it is like till the end, till I meet my death, I'm going to have the problem. So you please kindly educate them what is the problem they have got and how to overcome it with whatever means available to them. So the education of the patients plays a main role, which motivates them and brings them back for your treatment devices, whatever you're going to plan for that particular patient. Next comes reduction of pain and swelling, which are the two main problems of these patients. And then comes the mobilization of joints, which will minimize the deformity also, and it prevents the further deformity which is going to happen for these cases. And also we should concentrate how to increase the range of movements and function for this patient. And there is a stress on the strengthening of the muscles, because already the joints are invaded by this autoimmune disorder. So who is bad? The muscles. So we need to protect the muscles, thereby the strengthening of the muscles plays a very important role in the management of these patients. Next slide. So coming to the recent trends, see, there are a lot of modalities available. I'm not going to discuss in detail with all the modalities available in physiotherapy, which is going to have a main role in pain relief. Rather than I'm going to stress upon those trends in physiotherapy which has been developed in the recent era and which is more suitable for these patients to meet with their activities of daily living. So in the recent years, there is an evolution of many new trends to make the dream come true for the rheumatoid arthritis patients in promoting their quality of life. And with this new trends, it cannot be denied that the physiotherapists have a very, very wide role in the rehabilitation of the rheumatoid arthritis patients. Next slide. As I told you, to prevent the dreadful devil pain, which is catch-holding the breath of all these rheumatoid arthritis patients, we have got the various therapeutic modalities is going to help them, like cryotherapy, moist heat therapy, wax bath, laser, ultrasound, IFT, TENS, NMES, UVR and IRR. You know about all these modalities in detail, so my concentration is not on these modalities, rather than on the role of exercises, which has evolved recently. Next slide. So nowadays, the exercises play a major role for these patients by maintaining their integrity with their daily activities. So we are going to discuss about the strengthening exercises, aerobic exercises, flexibility exercises, proprioceptive and the aquatic exercises in detail, how we are going to promote the quality of life using these. So coming to the exercise prescription, which is a new topic for physiotherapists, we have to keep in our mind what should be prescribed for these patients. All rheumatoid arthritis patients do not come with us with the same type of problems. So we rule out whatever they have got and we list it out with our assessment and we devise the treatment goals. Based on that, our exercise prescription is going to be there. So when we are going to make that exercise prescription, we need to keep up certain things in our mind. What are all those things? The first one is, by giving exercise, I am going to increase the metabolic cost of the physical activity by 50% more. Because already these people are having pain, stiffness, biomechanical inefficiency as well as gait abnormalities. So how am I going to meet with these demands of the patient by my treatment? So we are in that dilemma. Second one, the repetitive movements in activities such as walking and cycling may inhibit the ability of the arthritic sufferers in those activities. And the third thing, The exercise modes for both aerobic and strength training are largely determined by the site and severity of the affected joints. As I told you, the affected joints, the site as well as the severity is not the same in all the cases. So accordingly, you are in a position to determine the exercise whatever to be prescribed for those patients. And then you should also keep in your mind that poorly controlled exercises and high impact movements present a high risk for injury in deconditioned and poorly supported joints. Next slide. So first of all, coming to the strengthening exercises, what are the guidelines to be followed? You have to ensure, first of all, the client's physician has cleared the client to the exercise. Session, is it not? So avoid strengthening exercises that cause increased joint pain, and a frequency of 2 to 3 days per week is suggested. And many clients may need to initiate a program with 2 to 3 repetitions progressing to 10 to 12 repetitions. The acceptable modes of resistive exercises, what could be the resistive exercises we can give to these patients? That can include the free weights, the weight machines, the isometric exercises, and the elastic bands. We have got the isokinetic devices also for strengthening. And you need to keep in your mind that we need to avoid the high repetition, high resistance strength training exercises, which is going to cause a greater force impact on the affected joints. As you all have seen how it is affecting the joint, so we need to think and devise our strengthening exercise program for these patients. Next slide. What will be the advantage of giving strength training to these patients? First of all, it is going to strengthen those muscle groups which is going to help the joints which is very, very weak because of the rheumatoid arthritis invasion. Second thing, it is going to offer protection and stabilization of the affected joints. The joints will be doing shock absorption. Now they are not able to do it. So your strengthening exercises is going to improve the shock absorption. And then it is going to reduce the mechanical stresses that is hastening the cartilage degeneration. Next slide. So with that, we had the idea of strength training program. Now let me move to the next person in the exercise regimen, the next army, that is the aerobic exercises. The word aerobic exercises stresses that it is not for the muscles alone, it is also going to improve the cardiovascular endurance of a person. So coming to the guidelines, again, like strengthening exercises, obtain the medical clearance from the client's physician prior to begin the exercise session. And this aerobic exercises are going to involve smooth rhythmical activities using the larger muscle groups. You avoid those high impact exercise that is going to stress the affected joints again, like strength training program. Then what will be the frequency? The frequency is about 3 to 5 days per week. That is more suitable for the cases. And you need to set an intensity of around 6 to 80% of maximal heart rate. So when we speak about these aerobic exercises, we always calculate the maximal heart rate, is it not? So we need to devise the intensity by calculating the maximal heart rate of the patient, and we need to set the exercises so that he could reach a level of 60 to 80% of maximal heart rate and not more than that, owing to the VO2, maximum oxygen consumption of that particular patient. The aerobic activity may last from 5 minutes initially, and it can proceed to about 30 minutes depending on the initial fitness level of the client. And when progressing the exercise, you should always first increase the duration followed by the intensity. So increase the duration, like 5 minutes, from that you gradually go to 30 minutes rather than increasing the intensity first. Don't increase the maximum load for the patient. Next slide. And what could be the possible aerobic exercises? We know, I've already mentioned that the strength training program can be given with isokinetic devices and all, and using conventional weight training methods too. The aerobic exercises which could be very easily available for the patients will be swimming, brisk walking, cycling and dancing too will be an aerobic exercise. And we have already discussed with the intensity, frequency and duration of all these aerobic exercises. 60-80% of maximal heart rate, 3-5 days per week, initially 5 minutes per session, and then you can slowly progress it to 30 minutes of duration per session. So coming to the flexibility exercises, this is the new name given to the stretching exercises. So the flexibility exercises, it should also proceed with a proper warm-up program. The flexibility exercises needs warm-up in order to increase the internal body temperature and circulation. The way the joints are getting affected, gradually they cause tightness in the muscles and it results in the deformity. So in order to prevent that, the flexibility exercise program is going to help in a very great amount. So daily flexibility sessions targeting the major muscle groups can be safely done. Special attention should be given to the lower back, hamstrings, calves and front of the shoulder, as these areas frequently lose the flexibility with age. Of course, you need to concentrate on the muscles in the affected areas also. Apart from that, these are all the areas in general to be concentrated for the rheumatoid arthritis patient. The flexibility exercise should include static stretches that could be held for a duration of 10 to 30 seconds. And the static stretch should not cause much pain. So generally you say to the patient that when you feel a mild amount of pain, please let me know, so that you will come to know whether the patient, whether the muscle group has got stretched or not. So in this case, you see that you are not causing much pain as they are already suffering from a lot of pain. But rather a mild tension, if you experience a mild tension, that is typically felt by taking a joint to its optimal range of motion. With that, you can stop your stretch rather than the indicative of pain to stop with the stretch. Use caution not to overstretch the unstable joints, and the stretching should be performed through a pain-free range of motion so that it avoids the bouncing and the ballistic type of stretches. Next. Then comes the proprioceptive training, which was not practiced earlier, and recently we do practice it because of the role it has got in the improvement of the rheumatoid arthritic cases to meet with the demands of the daily living. As the joints are getting affected, the mechanoreceptors and those proprioceptors are not available to have a proper joint sense, which leads to improper balance and gait disturbances, and also in each and every movement of the affected joint. So for that, especially when the lower limbs are getting affected, you need to concentrate on this proprioceptive training a lot, which includes some exercises like ankle dorsiflexion or plantar flexion exercises, ankle inversion and eversion exercises, drawing circles with the foot, writing alphabet with the foot, wobble board exercises, partial weight bearing exercises, single leg balance, as though you are going to start on the stable surface and then you can progress to a soft unstable surface like trampoline. And the same exercise, the single leg balancing exercises, can be asked with the eyes closed. And dynamic balancing exercises can also be concentrated while throwing a ball like that, activities. Here there is a picture showing you a single leg balance exercise on a trampoline to improve the proprioception. And there are isokinetic devices also which could be used for strength training, We can use them for proprioceptive training also. And coming to the next man in the exercise regime is your aquatic exercises. That is nothing but the activities in water, hydrotherapy. See, the hydrotherapy can have slow velocity activity or rapid velocity activity, or it can be having a mixed velocity activity in an aquatic environment. The slow velocity activity in an aquatic environment can lead to decreased joint and soft tissue swelling, inflammation or sometimes restriction of the joints, increased joint integrity and mobility. The rapid velocity activity can increase the strength, power and endurance, and the mixed velocity activity can increase the motor function, and it can also improve the quality and quantity of movement between and across the various body segments. The principle behind the aquatic exercises and in which way these principles is going to help you out. The buoyancy force is going to reduce the weight on those painful joints, and it is also going to assist the movement. The warm water, what we take for the aquatic exercise, it is going to increase the blood flow to the muscles and it is going to improve the flexibility. The hydrostatic pressure is going to reduce the swelling, and the viscosity will increase body awareness, and it can offer a resistive force. And the turbulent principle offered in the aquatic exercise can create a sensory overload and decrease the perception of pain. And some of the recent aquatic devices are hydrotone belts, float cushions, thigh pillows, aquaflex paddles, hydrotone boots, the fins or the zoomers, hydrofit dumbbells, wonderboard, buoyancy and resistance cuffs. Even I'm not well versed with all these devices. All these are some of the aquatic devices is used to provide the aquatic activity for these patients. These are the photographs showing you the aquatic therapy. Next. And then comes the AMG biofeedback. So biofeedback, it's a word, it is going to use your amplified electric voltage generated by the muscles as visual, auditory or sensory feedback to initiate, inhibit or train a muscle contraction. So whenever a muscle action is being inhibited or it is being affected due to the joint involvement in rheumatoid arthritic cases, you can study and analyze the muscle, and also you can give a biofeedback to these muscles to improve the function in those joints. Next. The usual biofeedback equipment is going to consist the following: the surface electrodes, amplifier, signal processor, audio speaker and a video display unit. And here is a flow chart showing you how the biofeedback device is going to help the patient to promote his or her motor behavior. The biofeedback device is going to give a visual or audio output as the patient is doing the activity, and the information is given to the patient. The audio feedback or the visual feedback is fed to the patient, and the desired movement attempt is can be modified through the ongoing sensory schema or the recall schema operating in the patient's brain, and then it can alter the motor behavior of the patient. Thereby you can bring the improvement in whatever activity you are trying out from that particular patient. So this biofeedback can be used in rheumatoid, as you like physiotherapists are well versed in using the biofeedback device for neuromuscular rehabilitation. It's all the same principle we are going to use in case of rheumatoid arthritis cases also. We are going to incorporate the biofeedback device in strength training, balance training, to alter the gait patterns and also to detect the energy expenditure of gait and to minimize it. Next. Mobilization techniques. Recently the field of physiotherapy is experiencing the saga of mobilization to relieve the pain effectively, and you have heard about various approaches. These approaches are for the spinal manipulations, for degenerative conditions and other pathological conditions which is causing the pain. We are also having mobilization techniques which could be used for the rheumatoid arthritis case. Next slide. Like glides, we give gentle traction, we give deep friction massage, and some of the soft manipulation techniques like myofascial release and muscle energy techniques can also be used. Then we have got the neuromuscular electrical stimulation in the field of electrotherapy. Already I have listed the electrotherapeutic devices which could be used to relieve the pain and swelling in rheumatoid arthritis cases. And here we have got the latest advancements in the field of electrotherapy, that is the neuromuscular electrical stimulation. It is for facilitating and strengthening the muscle groups. The neuromuscular electrical stimulation is resulting in direct activation of the motor neuron pool, and it is increasing the motor unit firing by direct stimulation of the efferent fibers as well as the muscle membranes. Here is a picture showing you the fixation of electrodes on quadriceps for neuromuscular electrical stimulation. And there are researches done to prove how much recovery of muscle is there, how much percentage of recovery of muscle is there when it is getting affected by means of using neuromuscular electrical stimulation. This particular table shows you that the neuromuscular electrical muscle stimulation is having the more percentage recovery of muscle, and the courtesy is from Snyder Mackler et al. 1995 in the study done by them. And then we have got the fluidotherapy in rheumatoid arthritis. What is fluidotherapy? It is a dry superficial thermal physical agent that transfers the heat to the soft tissues by agitation of heated air and molecular particles. And what could be the advantage of this fluidotherapy? The heat induced vasodilatation is going to cause increased blood flow and cell metabolism. It is going to have a mechanical skin stimulation. It is going to prevent the limb edema due to anti-gravity limb position during the treatment, and it is also promoting tissue healing. And though orthotist plays a separate role, we cannot deny their role in supporting the patients of rheumatoid arthritis. They offer the joint protection and also preventing the deformities. So the role of orthotist is also should go along with the physiotherapist, so that the joints are protected in a proper way and we can offer them the best. Finally, nowadays community-based physical therapy in rheumatoid arthritis plays a very, very important role, because you are giving everything at their doorstep. Every patient requires it, because in India, we don't have the facility of bringing all those sufferers to the hospital. So it is our duty to go to their doorstep to get them well. So physical therapy is tailored, especially in the community-based setup. The physical therapy is tailored to goals identified by patients. And all patients receive education and modalities of treatment, which includes the patient-specific exercises. This intervention significantly improves the self-efficacy, disease management knowledge in people with rheumatoid arthritis. And a study on community-based rehabilitation have shown that the morning stiffness of rheumatoid arthritic cases have gone down to a greater extent by means of community physical therapy. So the recent trends in physiotherapy should include the community-based physical therapy also, to highlight the improvement of rheumatoid arthritis patients. You may be wondering why I am showing the face of a baby over here. The community physiotherapist is like a mother who understands the need of the child and gives it at the level what it needs. So the role of community-based physical therapist can be compared to a mother who is taking care of a baby. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a quick and a brief presentation. I think probably since we are running short of time, I think I will leave the questions to be asked, I think during the last coffee break session which we have. I think I conclude the session at this point of time.
I request Dr. Chandrasekhar to hand over the monitors to Dr. Rajan Sanghi and Dr. Murthraj.